Everybody put three fingers in the air. The sky's falling, the wind is calling. Stand for something or die in the morning. Section 80, high power.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that our own mind has to be changed. We have to change our mind about ourselves.
In what way?
Well, so he teaches us the importance of moral reformation, a knowledge of self. And for instance, the average so-called Negro, he doesn't think that he can go into business and provide jobs for himself. And because of this, he thinks that he can only get a job from the white man, or he can only get clothes from the white man, or he can only get food from the white man. And we who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad are taught that the same thing that the white man has done for himself and his kind, if our people could be if we could be cured of our slave mentality that was indoctrinated into us during slavery, we would realize that just as the white man can do these things for himself and his kind, we can get together in unity and harmony and do the same thing for ourselves and our kind.
Greetings and welcome back to the Woke Podcast. I am your host, Brandon Jones, and in today's episode, you'll be listening to part one of a two-part series of me talking to my OG, Sam Simmons. Now, most of the listeners have never heard of Sam Simmons, but Sam, he is one of those guys in the community with tons of wisdom. He's been doing a lot of community-based work, trying to advance the black community all across the Midwest, but more specifically, here in the Twin Cities of Minnesota. And like many of our elders, they don't get the recognition. You know, everybody doesn't have the big name and is on the big stage, but we have such a wealth of genius, such a wealth of knowledge that doesn't get passed through. And I just wanted to have a sit-down conversation with somebody who I've learned a tremendous amount of information from and share it with you guys. So let me give you a quick introduction to who Sam Simmons is. Mr. Simmons is a licensed alcohol and drug counselor with over 25 years of experience as a behavioral consultant. He specializes in chemical dependency, intimate partner violence, and historical trauma. He's nationally known for the trainings that he does across the nation, specifically around African Americans and dealing with historical trauma. He's also locally known for a show that he has on 89.9 KMOJ entitled Voices that he does with the co-host weekly. He also has a pretty powerful conference called Community Empowerment Through Black Men Healing that he does on an annual basis right here in the Twin Cities of Minnesota. So check out part one of my interview with Sam Simmons. Trust me, you're going to get a lot of knowledge bombs and your perspective will get shifted. And part two is just going to be just as heavy. So tune in, share it with people that you love, like it, comment, and enjoy. Peace. So tell everybody who you are. How did you get into this work?
I'm Sam Simmons, and I am a behavioral consultant and licensed chemical dependency counselor. And how did I get into this work? I ask myself that question quite often, considering that my work life really starts with working in a factory, driving a truck, and being injured driving, unloading a truck, and going in the hospital. Behind that, and going through a clinic to address, to deal with my pain, and met this what does he call him, the psychologist. He says the ugly white man, you know, with a crooked nose, Dr. Hardy, interesting dude, you know, from Detroit. He's, you know, hung out with brothers. You could tell he hung out with brothers. And he started talking to me about this thing called self-defeating behavior. He actually wrote a book on it. And really, folks always took it for granted because it really, you know, everybody hear the term self-defeating behavior, but he actually broke it down, right? And it made sense to me, you know, how your past can have a major effect on your present and how you can continually repeat that over and over again because you haven't really connected the dots to your past, right? and actually started teaching the class. You know, he one of the interesting things he said to me, he says, "You get it." He says, "You need to share this with your own folks." You know, he says, "I can't do it."
Yeah.
You know, he says the brothers like me and stuff, but mm-hmm. they need to hear it from you.
Right.
And, you know, that was like the first time, unfortunately, somebody, well, the second time, but the first major time somebody said I could do something right. and really meant it, mm-hmm. which is unfortunate to even say that. Right.
Right.
You know, considering, you know, I was raised with my father and mother, and, you know, we can talk about that,
sure.
you know, somewhere down the line. But that, I think, is the real beginning of that. And then later on, I started working in the chronic pain clinic, did some stuff around mental health. And then I met another a gentleman who was running a program in the community. Up until that time, I never worked in the Black community, you know. Mm-hmm. Kind of raised in the projects and that kind of stuff, but I never really worked in specifically in the Black community.
Right.
And somebody met me in the pain clinic. He says, "You know, we could really use your work in the community." Mm-hmm. And so he had a clinic. A white guy had a clinic, and he was helping a brother have his own clinic. He set the framework up, and so he says, "Would you help him get his clinic up and running?" And I, you know, and I said, "Yeah." And the ironic part that, you know, I, you know, one of the things I try to be honest about my full experience is I never was so scared to death than working with Black men.
Wow.
You know.
Yeah, why was that?
Because they were scary. In my mind, you know, I mean, you know, yeah, I was grazed in the projects, but the thing is we were a middle-class kind of bougie family raised in the projects, mm-hmm. Basically because my father was comfortable there and it was cheap.
Right.
You know, we could afford to move out of the projects, mm-hmm. but that was where he was familiar with. And my mother, who was a real bougie and, you know, really let us know that we wouldn't like them people. That's what right. she would literally say. So
wow.
I never realized how much that affected how I was dealing with Black people myself. Right.
Right.
And so, you know, and then we went to a mixed church. So I had relationships with both Blacks and whites, but we was in a church setting. So it was more of a structured setting.
Right.
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 And took on this project to work with groups of brothers. And it was a program that was doing a unique thing where they were dealing with chemical dependency and domestic violence at the same time.
Okay.
Which at that time was unheard of.
Sure.
You know, if you had a client who had an issue with domestic violence, mm-hmm. he had to go deal with the domestic violence before he could go to treatment.
Okay.
Right?
Right, right.
But think about that. You got to go to domestic violence class before you go to treatment. Right. So you go to domestic violence class, you come to the class drunk,
right.
now you get thrown out. Right?
Right?
Okay?
Right.
Or you go to treatment, and then you beat your girlfriend up while you're in treatment,
right.
you get thrown out.
Right, right, right.
Right? So it was like genius.
Right.
So, you know, far as I was concerned. So was doing that, working with the brothers. And the first session, the brothers just ate me up. They knew that. I mean, they could smell fresh meat.
Sure.
You know, it's like, we know this Negro. We just will talk real crazy to him. And they did. Right,
right, right.
And I had a conversation with myself and said, "Okay, we're gonna make this work."
Mm-hmm.
And then remember how it was in the projects,
right?
You know, because you know I got beat up regularly
okay.
in the projects. Okay. You know, when they talk about bullying today,
sure.
shoot, this ain't nothing by the way. Shoot, you know, folks, you know, just beating you up because you had more than them.
Right.
I understand it now because of the work, but as a kid, it was like it don't make no sense.
Right.
When if you just asked me for it, I'd probably give it to you.
Right.
You know, because I was so need of being liked, shoot, you could have had the shirt off my back if you
sure.
asked for it. Why you gotta beat me up?
Right, which is also kind of a self-defeating behavior.
Behavior, right. Right. Yeah. Oh yeah. That neediness. Oh, definitely.
Right.
You know, and it caused me a lot of trauma over the years.
Sure.
Right.
Absolutely.
And so, the first two sessions were shaky. The next session, I came back, and when I came back, and it's like, "Look, dudes, you know, I don't have to put up with this. You know, I'm here to help you. And if you can't understand I'm here to help you, we can have empty chairs. And I ain't got no problem with no empty chairs.
Right.
I'm not here to make no friends with you. I ain't here to tell you kumbaya. I ain't on none of that stuff. And as we went on, the guys are like, oh, you know, and, right. and they like responded to that, you know, and it's like, tell me about you. You know, let's see if we can make this work. So we actually, you know, I can say now we actually was learning on the job together.
Sure.
And, sure. and while I was helping them work through this trauma stuff, but you know, really, by accident, I think, you know, it's like the more I would share with them my life and talk about the things I learned about in life, which made them like, oh, this is the first black person I know
sure.
telling the truth about what happened to him.
Sure.
What made it okay for them to tell the truth about what happened to them
to themselves,
and
right.
feel safe.
Right.
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 And so as I was working in the community, still working in the pain clinic, which was primarily white individuals, okay, I realized that the common denominator by between all of these was I was dealing with people's trauma and how their trauma was getting in the way of them being well, okay? You know, chronic pain, the trauma was in the way because... Okay, so when we talk about chronic pain, we're talking about people who might have had an injury for whatever reason. By the time we closed the program, most of them were personal injury cases, auto cases and that kind of stuff, right. injured backs and that kind of thing. And not everybody who get injured ends up with chronic pain,
right?
Right. And what we realized is that like 70% of the folks who came through the program and I started paying attention to their behavior, they were perfectionists, caretakers, and workaholics. And what I realized with that was a sociably acceptable way in America to hide your pain.
Wow.
Okay. Wow. So what do we mean by caretaker? Well, it's like I get in your business so I don't have to deal with my business. So we see counselors and therapists and other people, you know, community program folks who are, if you check their lives, you know, it's like, how's your life? You know, you see all this craziness. And I used to see that in our program. You go in the staff lounge and listen to the staff, and it's like, ooh, you got some raggedy life. But they were good at what they did with people,
right?
But they couldn't manage their lives with a damn.
Right.
And so they would hide their pain in helping other people with their pain.
Sure.
And then when them people would use them up, then they want to be mad at the people.
Right, right.
And so those folks stayed busy all the time. So like, you know, so when they would get injured, they didn't know how to be home with their own thoughts. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so they wouldn't follow what the doctor said. If the doctor said go home and rest for 4 weeks, they go rest a week and a day and a half.
Yeah.
You know, these are the folks you work with that would show up sick and stuff like that on your job, you know, and always happy to be there, you know, and make the coffee early in the morning and, you know, just want to please people. Right.
Right. Right.
And then a perfectionist, all or nothing.
Right.
All or nothing. Mm-hmm. Not, you know, so you're always busy. So it really was about staying emotionally distracted.
Sure.
You know, sure. And the same thing with workaholic. You know, I got married in when I was 19. I had a couple kids, owned my own house, had a job, two jobs and a paper route.
Sure.
Literally.
Sure.
You know, and being a young black man was like, you know, I was getting all kind of praise for, you're such a good husband and father. I'm not really.
Right.
You know, I was a great provider, but my father was.
Sure.
You know, I was imitating my father. He was a great, he was a good provider, but emotionally I had no connection to him.
Sure.
You know, we were just there. And over the years, I've seen a lot of black men whose position, they're in the house.
Right.
They're just there.
Right.
But that if you, when we start talking about the history of that, you'll understand that. But, you know, I wasn't a good husband or a good father, but I knew how to work. Mm-hmm. So working helped me be distracted.
Sure. Emotionally.
Right.
Right, right.
So a lot of these characteristics were mine. So mm-hmm. that's why it was easy to see them in the clients.
Sure.
Right. And I started connecting those dots. But again, in America, you can hide behind those kind of characteristics.
Sure.
Your trauma, you know, because, mm-hmm. oh man, he's great. He does that perfectly. But then we would talk to their family.
Right.
And their families were just being brutalized by these folks, right? Mm. So think about a perfectionist who wants everything perfectly, who and especially a male perfectionist,
right.
workaholic. He's not really home, and now all of a sudden he's injured, and he has to be home with his kids, okay?
Sure.
And so the kids would talk about that the daddy would come by and change everything,
sure.
you know?
Sure.
You know, because, you know, mama had a routine. Yep. You know,
yeah.
you know, and the kids don't learn the routine, and he was disrupting the routine and right. hard on them, and it wasn't good enough. Because the thing sure. about being raised by a perfectionist,
yeah,
how it feels,
sure, sure,
and so you pass it on to trauma,
right,
in a way,
right.
So that's how I really got. I started connecting the dots between these middle class white individuals,
right,
the brother in the hood,
right,
okay. And really started connecting the dots to the trauma,
right?
Right.
Right.
Later on, when the pain clinic closed, because I had been there for 20 years, and you know, so I got comfortable,
sure,
right?
Sure.
Making that easy, good money,
yep,
right?
Yep.
You know, again, and so often, you know, kind of doing extra, you know, in the community because that
sure.
was my side job,
sure.
you know. When the pain clinic closed, I had to figure out what the heck to do,
sure,
and luckily, you know, I had funds to get me by for a while. Then I started, you know, being more involved in the community.
Mm-hmm.
And I there was a request for me to be part of this new project called the Men's Project, you
okay.
know, which was interesting. The start of the Men's Project came from one of our white commissioners driving through the black neighborhood and saying, why are they, you know, in the newspaper, I still have the article. The question was, why when we got this economic vitality, we got black men standing on the corner doing nothing. And right. then we had one of our black intellectuals say, well, we need jobs and we need support for these men. And if you give us some money, we can make it work.
Okay.
So they brought all these community leaders and,
mm-hmm.
you know, black folks who've been working in the community. And I got chose.
Okay.
And I told them I didn't want to.
Okay.
And they sent me another letter that says, you have been chosen and show up. And so I did.
Okay.
And the concept on paper looked good, like many concepts in our community
right.
on paper look good,
right,
right? And so I started doing some more closer work in the community. And in the community here, as many around the country, you got the black side of the community. Right,
right.
The side that shows up on the news all the time, even though maybe all black folks don't live there, but
mm-hmm.
it's that side,
right.
you know? You know, those sides of the community, like those Fergusons and Baltimore's
sure.
and all these other kind of
right. West Baltimore.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. All these places. Right.
Right? North Philadelphia.
Yes.
Right.
You know, and, you know, even though, you know, here in Minnesota, people don't think black folks are here. They're here.
Yeah.
You know,
North
you
Minneapolis.
Know. Yeah. North yeah. Minneapolis.
East side of St. Paul.
Yeah. Yeah. But, one of the things, you know, because again, one of the things I like to do is, you know, look at an issue and just think about it. And then I like to step back from it, right?
Right, right.
And the question was, this is the real journey here. The question was, how do you spend $20 to $30 million or even more, I think it's much more than that now,
sure.
of nonprofit money in a community over 10, 20 years
mm-hmm.
and not have it improve significantly or sustainably?
Sure.
Because there's been improvements up and down, but sustainably.
Right.
What are you missing?
Right.
And there was a, and you know, because the question is, you know, depending on what side of the coin you on, is like, mm-hmm. well, you know, those people over there, they don't care.
Right.
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 The people over there ain't doing good work. Mm-hmm. Right. Well, both of them wasn't true. There's a lot of folks who care.
Right.
And there was a lot of folks doing good work. Granted that we had our poverty pimps and all this other kind of stuff, but there was more folks who cared and was doing good work, I believe.
Sure.
Okay. So it wasn't that.
Right.
And there, you know, and there was folks outside the community, I think, cared and wanted better too. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, we can debate on, you know, their motives, but right. still the typical answers
sure.
weren't there.
Right, right.
And what came to me slowly was nobody was talking about trauma. Mm. Now, everybody want to talk about, use the word now, but nobody was talking about trauma in relationship to a black community.
Right.
And on, and then you add, nobody was talking about black male trauma.
Mm. Right.
On top of that.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And I found that that part really interesting, because if you, when we would look at issues in the community, black men were involved sure. majorly, the so-called bad issues,
sure,
right?
Sure.
And it's like, okay, if you ignore a whole gender's trauma, but they are the ones who contribute greatly to the trauma that you are experiencing in the community, that is stupid to me.
Okay.
And, but the thing is we do that across the board, no matter what culture it is.
Right.
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 But when it comes to black men, it's a whole nother level.
Sure,
right.
Because sure.
a black man, after he gets past 10 years old, maybe some people say six.
Sure.
He is never seen as a victim again.
Mm,
or wow. even possible being a victim.
Sure.
Not just by the system, by our own people.
Right.
Okay.
Wow.
And so my journey really started to really, cause I, you know, thing is you have to start doing something differently.
Right.
And you're doing the same old thing and expecting a different outcome is, you know, we all know what that is. Cause we laugh sure. about it and tease about it. You know, it's insanity and that kind
right,
of stuff.
Right, right.
But you know, that's all cute and stuff, but we need to get deeper than that.
Sure.
So, you know, start thinking about this whole thing about black male trauma. Started working at another program in the community with a brother by the name of James Muhammad.
Okay.
And this brother is deep. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, he's Afrocentric. He used to be with the Nation and actually a high lieutenant in the Nation, mm-hmm. had dealt with some depression and kind of worked himself through that
sure.
and was restarting his career and working at this program. And we sat down. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and he, you know, one of the things, his focus was always kind of on what the man is doing to the people.
Sure.
Right.
Sure.
And my thing was, okay, that's fine, but what is the people doing to each other?
Sure.
Right?
Sure, right, right.
And as we often do, traumatized people do, we don't hear.
Yeah.
Okay.
Trauma affects our
hearing. Yeah, because yeah, trauma affects our hearing, affects what we see.
Mm-hmm.
It can almost affect what we smell,
sure.
you know, and it definitely sure. affect what we say.
Sure.
Right?
Absolutely.
So that was going on between two black men, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, we go back and forth and you can almost see it. Brother, you don't understand. You know, the man is he has no regard for us as men and treats us like animals. And I said, well, yeah, you might be right. But think about how we treat women and how we treat each other
sure.
and the violence in the street.
Sure.
Well, brother, why are you blaming the victim? And well, you know, I'm not trying to blame the victim, but, you know, you ain't listening to me. And it literally got into a heated argument.
Wow.
And the argument got so heated, and we had, this was like our first true meeting.
Right.
Right. It, we were in his office arguing so much the door was literally rattling. Right. And the organization that he was working at was primarily white. So they were scared to knock on the door.
Sure.
Right. And so we got this door rattling and you know, and folk, and then you can, you know, folks find out that folks was outside the door worrying about, you know, if they're going to kill each other, you know,
yeah,
you know, it's
yeah.
like, it's like the old old days when we used to put cats and rats in a garbage can to beat it and see, you know, and see what kind of, you know, what come out. You know, I know that's a sick analogy, but I'm a little sick. Yeah. Okay, so all of a sudden it goes instantly quiet, because what we realize is we both were right. Mm. Two things can be true at the same time.
Mm. Yeah.
And on that day was the beginning of really focusing on black male trauma. Because one of the things we agreed on, no matter which direction we was coming at this, was if we didn't deal with the trauma that we was carrying,
right,
presently, mm-hmm. and the trauma that we were born with historically,
right,
that it was going to be difficult to see and feel the healing.
Right.
And that was the beginning of the process of our conference called Community Empowerment Through Black Man Healing. Mm-hmm. And that was 9 years ago. And it's probably the most, probably the greatest things that I have been involved with. And even then, you know, we had the idea. We didn't have no money. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you know, we had a little money our own, you know, but it was interesting, the response. Mm-hmm. Both black and white had difficulty with the concept.
Wow.
You know? Mm-hmm. I remember we had, when we started announcing, we wrote an article on why it was necessary, you know,
sure.
with the idea that if we address black men's trauma, then they would quit sharing their trauma with their women and children, and it would leave women an opportunity to deal with their healing, mm-hmm. and then the benefactor would be our children. Mm. And, you know, black folks really had a hard time with that, because again, mm-hmm. sometimes when we talk about trauma, it makes it difficult for us to see that two things can be true at the same time.
Right.
And I remember like yesterday, this sister that I have a lot of respect for, who has two adult sons who have done well. Both of them went to college. Mm-hmm. One of them used to play pro sports, and you know, and I mean, I can't say how much I respect with this this woman and the young man she raised. She was so taken back by just the title of the conference. I hear you getting ready to have a conference to heal black men. Mm. Well, that's all y'all talk about is black men. Heal, shoot, we need to heal because they cause so much pain and angst, shoot. Yeah. I don't know why you talking about them healing. It's like, sister, do you know what you're talking about?
Right.
I agree with you.
Right, right.
Okay? It's like, the reason we're focusing on black men healing, and you're right, we've had a lot of probably over-the-top focus on black men, right. and really about black men dying. Mm-hmm. And trying to keep black men alive,
right?
Because of our history. Do you understand? If all of them things you were saying, if we help black men deal with their pain, then you don't have to.
Right.
Then you don't have to. I don't disagree with the pain that black men has caused you. Mm. That is one of the reasons we're focusing on this.
Right.
And on top of that, you got two black sons. So I know you care about black men. Mm-hmm. So the thing is if that black man, again, if he deals with his pain, then you don't have to focus on his healing and you can focus on yours. Mm. She went quiet. She said, she paused. She said, have a good conference. Mm. And she walked out. I haven't seen her since.
Wow.
Wow. And then I had, you know, so-called community leaders, you know, you know, come up to me and, well, brother, why are you using your money? They got grants out here and they got foundations and, mm-hmm. you know, you need to just apply for a grant and find it. I said, man, ain't nobody trying to give me no money to heal no black man. Mm. Mm. I said, now, the issue is every grant I look at is they're talking about mentoring, yeah. you know, and they're talking about, you know, reentry
sure.
and, you know, all those pieces.
Right.
I'm talking about healing black men.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand how scary that is to some people?
Right.
And I said, on top of that, this conference ain't just about healing black men. See, mm-hmm. that's the tricky part.
Right, right.
This
right.
is about healing a whole community. We just starting with black men.
Sure. Right.
I said, and on top of that, why am I gonna get the money from who you call the enemy to fix me?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, brother, you know, you've always been difficult to deal with, so you know, you have your happy conference.
Mm.
Okay. Wow. Right. Yeah. And, you know, in the white community, well, Sam, we're not quite understanding what you're trying to do here. Mm-hmm. It really doesn't fit into any of these areas, just like I told the brother, you know, right. like, oh, fine. Okay. But I'm going to do it one way or the other.
Right.
Then, so we decide to have it in one of the community centers mm-hmm. locally. Yeah, we're going to leave that. Yeah, one of the community centers locally. And we decided that we was going to have a one-day conference. And okay. the conference was basically based on the question. If we focused on healing black men,
mm-hmm.
would that improve the condition of the community?
Mm-hmm.
And that was the question, okay?
Right.
So I got that. I got a brother that I know to cater the conference, and we figured out what the budget would be for maybe 100 people,
mm-hmm.
and so we charged $45 a person for that day.
Okay.
Oh my God! You thought I done cussed black people out. Now we getting back to that conversation wow. I had with some of the other black leaders. Why you got to charge?
Mm.
Why are you charging for a conference? You know, you don't want the community to come. You know, the community can't afford no $45, and then they just don't come.
Mm.
And mm-hmm. and I don't never see them questioning other stuff they want to buy.
Sure.
That ain't feeding them.
Sure.
Ain't housing them.
Right.
I just said $45.
Right, right.
I got to pay for all this stuff.
Right.
You know, you when it come, you gonna want to eat.
Right.
You know, I mean, so don't come.
Right.
So the lesson in that is, if you believe in something, you got to be able to invest in it.
Right. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there was many lessons at the time I didn't realize that came out of this. Right.
Right.
So the night before, only 35 people signed up.
Mm.
Luckily, I had a little bit of money that I had enough money to cover whatever the expenses of my own money.
Sure,
right?
Sure.
Just in case, because, you know, I can't be looking bad out here.
Sure.
135 folks showed up.
Wow. So only, you know, 35 registered, but right. people actually came today.
Okay. Right. And I think out of 135 was 10 whites.
Wow.
Right?
Right.
And on top of that...
Which is very important because we are in Minnesota.
Right.
And when we do have black, quote-unquote, black events, it tends to be almost more white folks than black people.
Right.
A la Black Lives Matter, but that's a whole other story. So
oh, no. See, now you're getting ready to start some stuff, man.
It's the truth.
Yeah, well, okay. So, yeah, only 10 whites showed up, and, you know, and people called them brave. But but they knew me, right?
Sure.
That's
sure.
why they showed up, right? Right? And they still talk about that experience, right? Right? Because their fear was we was gonna sit there and talk about white people.
Mm-hmm.
I do not waste my time talking about white people,
right?
I was like, why? Now I'll talk about systems,
sure.
Right. Well, I don't spend my time talking about white people, beating up white people.
Okay.
You know, because it has not been effective.
Right. Right.
Okay. Now, that don't mean I won't jack one up. That's yeah. No, I will do that. But the thing is we had the question. So we asked the overall question, if we focused on trauma and we started with the focus on black men,
right.
will that empower a community? right? Mm-hmm. And so we broke it down into the school system, the mental health system, the church. And so we had pastors and all these folks was in the same room. Right. And they asked the question. And we had, and matter of fact, that's probably one of the ones we have full tape on
sure.
in terms of our conference. And the thing, it was just, it was amazing. Folks still talk about the first one,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
And we asked that question. And the ironic part is a lot of these black folks had never met each other. Mm. That was the first time they met each other. They mm-hmm. didn't even know it was that many black professionals in Minnesota.
Wow.
All yeah. the outer suburbs. I mean, you talk about the networking that was happening in yeah. that moment.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Things ain't been the same since then, mm-hmm. right? Especially within that network, right?
Right.
And it was over and above what me and Brother Muhammad was. I mean, we were like almost in tears mm-hmm. by the time it was over.
Right.
Because we didn't know what was going to, we just went on our love of our folks mm-hmm. and wanted to show something different. And the big question was, will you continue this?
Right.
Because people said, you know, when black people start stuff, they don't finish it. Mm. Or if they do continue it, it changes up and gets to be fluff. So that made for a big challenge.
Yeah, right, right.
But that was the beginning of that whole conversation. And again, at that time, nobody was really talking about, in a real way, the trauma of the black community
right.
and how focusing on that could improve the condition of the community.
Right.
So that's, I know it's a long story about how we got started, but.
But that's great context, and it highlights a lot of where we are today, right?
Right.
Because it touches not only on just the community trauma in itself, but also the organizational trauma that kind of spills in, and why it is difficult for us to organize on a professional level as well as just on a basic communal level, because that trauma is there.
Right.
So speaking of the trauma, you know, one of the things that you're notable for across the nation is historical trauma.
Oh,
can you explain what historical trauma is, how you got introduced to it, and why is it important for us to understand?
Okay. So in my passion started with the conference and this whole concept around male trauma. The other question was, a lot of folks know about, have heard the term post-traumatic stress. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I was exposed to that by working at the pain clinic and in mental health, because I worked a little bit for a short period of time in a lock unit. So we're talking about over 20 years ago, we were talking about post-traumatic stress, and it wasn't in reference to military. It was in reference to, in a lot of cases, sexual assault victims, right? And when we look at post-traumatic stress, post-traumatic stress is usually developed after somebody's exposed to some trauma event, like physical assault, sexual assault, or even exposed to a disaster or accident. And not everybody experiences post-traumatic stress, but think about the symptoms here. Having this incident, reliving the incident with flashbacks and nightmares, avoiding people, places, and things and situations that may remind a person of the trauma, and being increased arousal. In other words, easily startled, feeling tense, having difficulty sleeping, and angry outbursts. And when I read that, and by this time I was doing work in the community, and so my question was, what if you have a community, a whole community, experiencing these symptoms? What do you call that? And because that's what I was seeing. Now that my eyes are open and looking at, the vision of the trauma in the community. And so in my search, I came across, intergenerational trauma. And, that's a trauma that unresolved trauma that of one generation, and then passed on to another generation. And you notice unresolved trauma or trauma been ignored. Okay.
Right.
And you know, it got recognized for the first time by clinicians in about 1966. And in them circumstances where it was actually in Canada that they had these clinicians that were dealing with children of Holocaust survivors. And they were seeing trauma responses
right
in these children, and they hadn't experienced the trauma. Okay.
Right.
And up until then, they would tell them it's all in their head. You know, well, you know how, you know, the systems, when they can't, when they don't have the answer, then it don't exist. Right.
Sure.
You know, you can see all the evidence going on, but it don't exist unless right. they have the answer. And so in 1966, they recognized this whole thing about intergenerational trauma. And the thing is, you know, that's probably easy for folks to understand. Think about it.
Right.
The trauma of my parents.
Mm-hmm.
Is the trauma of mine.
Right.
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 I remember one of the first lectures that I got probably known about, because I used to have a cable show for a little while too.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my first lectures that really got notoriety is the one I did on the family, called The Family Story.
Mm.
And basically what I was, you know, I was at this conference. We were having a conference on Black depression. No, we could talk about depression, but sure. We're talking about trauma. And I really wasn't talking about trauma at that point either, or using the words a lot.
Right.
And they asked me, you know, I was like a backup presenter. You know, I didn't get initially asked. They just said, Sam, you got something you could fill in and all like that. So, you know, I was like in the secondary room.
Right.
Right.
Right. Right. Right.
And everybody was talking about the depression. Right. And I wanted to talk about something different. And I decided to talk about my family, degenerations of my family, and which really was talking about intergenerational trauma.
Right.
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 You know, and how that trauma was affected me, and how if I didn't get a handle on it, would have had a severe effect on my children.
Right.
Okay. Because, I mean, you know, you think about my grandfather, my mother's father, he was a product I would call it rape.
Okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. You know, other folks might call it something else.
Sure.
But he was great grandmother worked, the story is she worked in a white person's house, you know, as many of our Black women did back
right,
then.
Right.
And some people say still now.
Yeah.
Okay. And the owner of the house, She was pregnant by him.
By him, okay.
Right. But she had to hide the child.
Mm.
So my grandfather was raised by his aunt.
Mm.
He wasn't raised by his mother.
Sure.
Wow. Okay. And my aunt and her kids are purple Black.
Mm.
My grandfather could almost pass for white.
Wow.
So they used to call him Whitey.
Mm-hmm.
You know, okay. And he actually was a loan shark. He used to take advantage of folks. You know, he would charge folks 50 cents on the dollar. He was a supervisor on the boat dock.
Because
in Charleston, you know, you got that shipping lane and you got the naval base and all the other kinds of
Charleston, stuff. Charleston, South Carolina.
Right.
Okay, gotcha.
And, you know, my grandfather, you know, was a big womanizer, pretty man, because he let everybody know he pretty, you know, really curly hair, looked like a tan Colonel Sanders, because he wore a white suit all the time. But the thing is I remember spending time with him before he died and watching him as he got older, watch TV, and he started telling the stories of his trauma and, and the family while he was drinking his gin.
Because,
you know, he had I was watching a Black man who had a lot of regrets. And my mother's mother, my grandmother, was kind of, in my eyes, was one of the meanest people I ever met.
Right.
just bitter, right? Mm-hmm. And she was really abusive to my mother to the point where they a family took her away. So my mother was kind of raised in downtown Charleston with an upper class black family, light-skinned black family, right? Mm-hmm. And she used to wear petticoats and all these other kind of stuff, like a little China doll.
Sure.
And so she had her trauma, right?
Right.
And the result of her trauma is she learned that if I play victim, people be good to me.
Yeah.
Right.
Interesting.
And, you know, and so you get my father, who's raised by a sharecropper.
Right.
Who was similar to Mr. in Color Purple. Okay. Angry black man. But, you know, there was a lot of those old black men down south who were just bitter, man. I mean, because if you dug into their trauma.
Yeah.
I mean, think about how many layers, because when we're talking about a sharecropper, we're talking about either a child of slavery or very close to a child of slavery.
Right.
Okay. And, you know, so my father was raised on the sharecropper farm and didn't get his first real pair of shoes until he was 18.
Wow.
And, you know, he went to a one-room shack school maybe an hour a day because you couldn't spend no more an hour a day from the field.
Cause sure.
You know, because you was in the field trying to make that money.
Right, right.
But my grandfather was a trip, but he was scared to death of my grandmother, who was a highly, highly, highly spiritual woman.
Sure.
You know,
right.
I mean, she was one of them folks, you know, where, you know, when you look at The Color Purple, if you don't do right by me, you know, we'll put that devilish curse on you, you know, so he wouldn't mess with her, you know, but my father was more, he was closer to his mother.
Right.
And really didn't have a good relationship with his father.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when my grandfather got sick, or I think he got injured or whatever,
right.
You know, because he was a bootlegger too, you know, and had them little side jobs and that kind of stuff. To the end, I think my father was trying to get the old man to say he loved him, right? So you got these two wounded people who get together downtown Charleston. My father get his first pair of shoes at 18, goes live with his older sister.
Mm.
Okay, meets my mama and her sister, you know, who both, you know, pretty black women, fair skin, good hair, black women.
Sure.
Right.
Sure.
Who had this rivalry going on. And, you know, there's some stories about that, too. Well, my mother got pregnant with me.
Okay.
And so they got married.
Okay.
You know, so so that's one of them things when we, you know, people will probably maybe say them, but basically, that's a trauma too when you ain't planning on having a child.
Right, right.
And you barely know each other.
Right, which is interesting because we know that in our community, especially during those times, because we're talking, what, 40s?
Yes.
Okay, both, so we're talking 40s, where you had that condition that if someone got pregnant, the expectation was you get married and figure it out.
Right.
Versus what we've had now and in the last 30 to 40 years is if you get pregnant, it's like, well, good luck.
Right. And
everybody, good luck to everybody.
Right, right. And the bad part about it is the adult in the family is the child who ain't born yet.
Damn.
Yeah. You know, they come in the world with a job.
Sure.
You know, trying to hold adults together.
Wow.
Yeah, but yeah, so they got married, you know, young. I think my mama was 17. She, you know, she was good in school, so she had been in school. My father, you know, he got the third grade, right?
Sure.
But he knew how to work, right?
Right.
And so, you know, the thing is my life was probably pretty good until I was 5. And then all hell break loose. You know, there was other women and all that.
Sure.
And so I grew up with domestic violence, but I was also in the church, too.
Sure, sure.
So we had these contradictions, and the church would tell my mama to you know, stick it out and all this other kind of stuff, which kind of messed me up and that kind of stuff. And, you know, I remember at 12 years old, because when you grow up in those kind of things, and you're the oldest child, you grow up quick. So I stopped being a child at 5.
Mm.
Okay.
Yep.
So I'm thinking about, so, you know, I think that led me to my work, because at 5, I'm starting thinking about, you know, what was real and what I was being told.
Right.
Right. I was being told one story, but what I was seeing in front of my eyes is a whole different story.
Right.
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 So at 12 years old, I sat my mama down like a little old man.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to my mother, after her and daddy, probably the next day after they'd been fighting and stuff, I said, why you and daddy stay together? Mm-hmm. And my mother said, because she was surprised that I asked her that question. I don't know why, because she, I had a emotionally incestuous relationship with my mother, mm-hmm. Because she was telling me stuff like I was her best friend. You should not do that to a child,
right?
About my daddy. I knew things about my daddy I had no business knowing, mm-hmm. And you got to work that out,
right?
So So I'm thinking I'm grown emotionally,
right?
So I'm having this adult conversation with my mama and asking them, the question, why did you two stay together? She got puzzled, she had a puzzled look on her face, and then she finally answered, because for you kids. And my response to her is, don't we get a choice? That didn't go over so well.
Yeah.
Now I'm still remembering the stars from that sure. experience, right?
Wow.
And so that continued, and then so you got their trauma,
right?
And I ended up being just like my father to a certain degree, wondering if my daddy liked me, because
sure.
my family had that kind of discipline that we see in Black families, where I shame you enough to get you to change,
right?
Right. That whole thing about beating you in public and
right.
All this other kind of stuff, that mm-hmm. shame based discipline,
sure.
That we still try to defend to this sure. day,
right.
And my father was emotionally hard on me, and mm-hmm. and once I started doing my trauma work, I realized that was how he was raised,
right.
So it was difficult, having your mom, because my mother and father, I didn't think they liked me much.
Sure.
But, I look at that and it's like, can you imagine when they would look at me that I was like, especially when they're going through their craziness.
Right.
I'm like almost, again, responsible for their craziness.
Right. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Cause you place the reason why what's going on is because they got pregnant with you,
right?
And then you start to self blame,
right?
What has happened because you came into the world,
right?
Yeah.
Right.
And that's a lot for any person to take, take that kind of responsibility, but especially for a child,
right?
And I think that happens a lot with our children. Is one, they're forced to grow up faster than they need to,
right?
So they get robbed of a childhood,
right?
Which means their innocence gets taken away from them,
right?
Due to our conditioning,
right?
And two, they start to assume responsibilities that they're not prepared for. They don't have the skills necessarily, and it's not their own stuff.
That's right.
Yeah.
And so you get that story, and lo and behold, guess how old was I got married?
Same age.
Yes.
18, 19.
19 years old. Wow. Right. I married an older woman though, okay. Who had a child,
Okay.
So I married an experienced woman, get it. That was after some other trauma in terms of another woman. I was really cared for, but mm-hmm. But the thing is we got married. I got married at an early age, and then we get to the point where, again, as I mentioned earlier, own my own house and all right. this other kind of stuff at an early age, but wasn't a good husband mm-hmm. and a good father, and broke up with my wife. I think we was together maybe two to three years, and mm-hmm. Later on. I say 35, I grew up, but around 25, I decided to be a fool and start running the streets, selling drugs, because I'm wild now, that kind of thing. And, almost one of the good things is I really didn't expose. The best thing I did was actually leave my first wife in reference to my children. Maybe sure. not at the time for me and her, right. but in reference to my children. Because I remember I said I had that conversation with my mama at 12?
Yeah.
I had that same conversation with my mama at 22.
Wow.
On the same couch.
Wow.
It was a really nice couch, yeah. but we had to reupholstered and was at our house. Because my first wife called my mama, and you know, at least that's the way I seen it. My mama showed up, let's put it that way.
Sure.
And wanted to have a conversation with me, talking about, you know, you should rethink this stuff. You know, you shouldn't leave your family and all this other kind of stuff. And I looked at mama. I said, mama, I'm not going to mess these children up like we got messed up.
Wow.
I can't do that.
Right.
I said, I'm not home all the time and all that, because me and her ain't getting along.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not doing that to my children.
Right.
You and daddy stayed together for 30 years. And so I left home when I was 18, right?
Right.
You stayed together for 30 years. And then when you decide to get a divorce, you call me up, because I'm the oldest child who's been an adult running the family since I've been five, and asked me if it's okay for them to get a divorce. Can you believe that?
Wow.
and I started laughing, and they got offended, because my mother and father came up to Minnesota together.
Wow.
To tell me this, we wanted you to know that we're thinking about getting a divorce, and we wanted to let you know and wanted to know how you feel about that. And I started laughing at them in their face.
Wow.
It's like, I don't care what you old people do. I'm already screwed up.
Sure.
It's like, you can't help me now.
Right, right, right.
Too late.
Right, right.
You know, and I meant that.
Yeah.
You know, so, so, you know, I, in spite of myself, I managed to get myself right. And then, you know, the rest of the story would be, you know, the rest of the story would come to play. So that was, so that's a long way of giving you an example of intergenerational trauma as I seen it in that story.
Right.
And so in my travels, I hope people can keep up with me. In my travels, you know, there's this quote by Bob Hoffman. The fear of pain blinds us to the goal of healing. Only by seeing our problems clearly and experiencing them can we do something about them.
Mm.
So I was still looking for an answer to that question about if you had a community that was displaying post-traumatic stress. And I came across this whole conversation about historical trauma through a Dr. Marie Yellowhorse Braveheart.
So there you have it, folks. That was part one of a two-part series of my conversation with Sam Simmons. I'm sure that you picked up on a lot of his wisdom and knowledge that he has to share. So be sure to tune in to part two, where we go more in depth into this concept of historical trauma as it pertains to African Americans. If you like the podcast, be sure to share it with someone you care about. Be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, you can email me at Jones, J-O-N-E-S, at wokepodcast.com. Be sure to also subscribe to the podcast. More heat to come. Tune in. Peace.